Okay, so I've cleaned up the screen a little bit, Michael, to make this a little bit clearer. Now, let's look at this XI transpose XJ, and I'm now going to replace it with something. So I've just replaced it with a function, which I'm going to call a kernel, which takes XI and XJ as parameters and will return some number. Now again, as we've talked about before, we think of the XI transpose XJ as some notion of similarity, and so this kernel function is our representation still of similarity. Another way of thinking about that, by the way, is that this is the mechanism by which we inject domain knowledge into the support vector machine learning algorithm.
Just like we were injecting domain knowledge when we were thinking about K-nearest neighbors.
Yes, everything has domain knowledge, and everything ultimately comes back to K-nearest neighbors. I don't know why, and I don't know how, but it always seems to.
So the K in K-nearest neighbors and the K in kernel really stand for knowledge.
Oh, wow, that's pretty good. We should write a paper with that title. So the real neatness here, the neatness here is twofold. One is you can create these kernels, and these kernels can have arbitrary relationships to one another. So what you're really doing is projecting into some higher dimensional space where in that higher dimensional space, your points are in fact linearly separable. But the second bit is because you're using this kernel function to represent your domain knowledge, you don't actually have to do the computation of transforming the points into this higher dimensional space. I mean, in fact, if you think about it, with the last kernel that we used, computationally, there was actually no more work to be done. Before we were doing X transpose Y, and now we're still doing X transpose Y, except we're then squaring it. So that's just a constant bit more work, right?
So and that is a kernel, and another kernel is X transpose Y?
Yes, that's something I would call a kernel.
And the other kernel we talked about was just X transpose Y by itself. That's a kernel too, isn't it?
Oh, no, that's right. That's right. That's absolutely right. So that's a different kernel. You're absolutely right. Just X transpose Y is another kernel. Actually, we can write a general form of both of these, and it's a very typical kernel. It's the polynomial kernel where you have X transpose Y plus some constant, let's call it C, raised to some power P. And as you can see, both of those earlier kernels are, in fact, just a special case of this.
Okay, good.
And that should look familiar.
It reminds me of the regression lecture.
Exactly, where we're doing polynomial regression. So now, rather than doing polynomial regression the way we were thinking about it before, we use a polynomial kernel, and that will allow us to represent polynomial functions. And there are lots of other kernels you could come up with, Michael. So here's just a couple. I will just sort of leave them up to you to think about. And there's tons of them. So here's one that I happen to like. So that's a sort of radial basis kernel. Does that look familiar to you?
Well, let me make sure I understand that it's doing the right thing. So if X and Y are really close to each other, then it's like e to the minus 0 over something, which is like e to the 0, which is like 1. So their similarity is like 1 if they're on top of each other. If they're very far apart, then it's like their distance is something very big divided by something. E to the minus something very big is very close to 0. So it does have that kind of property, kind of like the sigmoid, where it transitions between 0 and 1. But it's not exactly the same shape as that.
Right. And in fact, it's symmetric. That the square of the distance between you and making an actual distance makes it always a positive value there, or at least a non-negative value there. And so it becomes symmetric. So it looks a lot more like a Gaussian.
Okay.
With some kind of width, which is represented by sigma. And there are tons and tons of these. Actually, if you wanted to get something that looked like a sigmoid, here's one where alpha is different from the other alphas, but I couldn't think of a different Greek letter. And this function gives you something that looks a lot more like a sigmoid. And there are tons and tons of these you can come up with. And there's been a lot of research over the years on what makes a good kernel function. The most important thing here, I think, is that it really captures your domain knowledge. It really captures your notion of similarity. You might notice, Michael, that since it's just an arbitrary function that returns a number, it means that X and Y, or the different data points you have, don't have to actually be points in a numerical space. They could be discrete variables. They could describe whether you're male or female. And so long as you have some notion of similarity to play around with that you can define that returns a number, then it doesn't matter. It'll always work.
So can you do things like, I don't know, strings or graphs or images?
Absolutely. You could think about two strings. How are two strings similar? Maybe they're similar if their edit distance is small. The number of transformations that you have to give in order to transform one string to another. If there are a few of those, then they're very similar. If there are a lot of those, then they're very dissimilar. You could talk about words like cat and lion and decide those are more similar than cat and mosquito, for example.
Because of the ears?
Yeah, mainly because of the ears.
All right. Then I think I understand.
Okay, good. So you might be curious, Michael, whether there are any bad kernel functions. There is actually an answer to that. While it's not clear whether there are any bad kernel functions, it is the case that in order for all the math to go through, there is a specific technical requirement of a kernel function. It has a name, and it's the Mercer condition. Have you ever heard of the Mercer condition?
I've heard the word. I actually used to live near Mercer County, New Jersey.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, so then I guess it's the condition of living near where Michael used to live. No, so the Mercer condition is a very technical thing. We'll talk about this again a little bit in homework assignment, but for your intuition in the meantime, it basically means it acts like a distance or it acts like a similarity. It's not an arbitrary thing that doesn't relate the various points together. Being positive semi-definite in this context means it's a well-behaved distance function.
Gotcha.